It was well into the winter before everything was finally put away and done with. The days grew colder and the nights came earlier. What activities that remained on the farm moved inside, and a lot of time was whiled away just gazing out the windows and recounting the experiences of the past season. Different, the land and the people had changed. All in all, it had been for most a very satisfying year. The crops pushed up and stretched out to their limits, and the memory would retain their image for many years to come. Particular pattern on the whole, and each began the year in his own way in some particular place at some specific time. Most of the places reflect on the people who own them. After years of rebuilding and living in, certain choices begin to speak. The peculiar tilt of the fence posts, the curtains over the kitchen sink, or the way the road meanders out back. Thank you. fresh turned, virgin earth, sometimes conjures up visions, a waist-high grain waving in the sun. Not on the surface. Shovelful of dirt, every gallon of water would in the end add up. And every weed, a blight, a dangerous insect had to be a thing of concern. It was a slow, bit by bit, inch by inch process. Over the weeks, it could be seen that things were growing at the set speed which hasn't changed for millions of years. But at the same time, beyond the circle of the farmer's work, there was another organic substance spreading over the surface of the earth. It was growing much faster, multiplying every fraction of a second, by the hundreds every minute, by the thousands every hour, by the hundreds of thousands every day, by the millions every week. Every year, more land disappears under houses and roads, suburbs and cities. The most formidable task facing mankind during the rest of the 20th century might be just to provide food enough to support the numbers. Not many of the men working in the fields could concern themselves with such huge and ominous problems, but there were many others elsewhere who were. At over 100 land-grant colleges and state universities, young students from all over the country pursued specialized knowledge and careers in the rapidly expanding sciences of modern farming. Agronomy, soil chemistry, plant pathology, ag economics, botany, veterinary medicine, mechanical engineering, nuclear physics. Out of education grew research, the bit-by-bit collection of data that ultimately leads to the discovery of basic truths, and has, in its practical applications, already reduced many of the farm's age-old problems to simple matters of routine procedure. Scattered around in several towns were the machine and tractor works. Every year they come up with some new contraptions to do the jobs people have been doing and do them better. Transformed into a machine that would march out across the fields and reap its weight in wheat every few hours. There's one thing that nobody has yet been able to do much about, and that's the weather. In early summer, when the land was drying out, the crops were nearing maturity, everybody kept an anxious eye on the horizon. almost everyone had to worry through a few thunder showers. But what if the worst had really happened? One had to expect and be prepared that someday it would. As the harvest time came closer, long lines of empty grain barges pushed north up the major river systems to wait beside the elevators. The great, hollow, concrete storage buildings that would receive the flood of grain when it began to pour off the prairies. Empty rail cars were routed out to stand ready along the fields. At the same time, manufactured goods, tin cans, cardboard boxes, baling wire, cellophane wrappers, spare parts, gasoline, shoes, and machines moved from the industrial centers toward the harvest. Rumors circulated that out on the prairie, things were big, and the cutting could start any day. Everything looked ready, but to the man with the discerning fingers or the deft pocket knife, it wasn't quite there yet. So there was nothing to do but just sit tight and wait. backyard swing, the rocking chair, the parlor, all quite suddenly became empty. The shed doors were thrown open, and the tarps came flying off. Out came the oil cans, grease guns, wrenches, hammers, and water canteens. Whetstones ground shiny new edges that come morning would start to cut. wheat harvest began on the southern rim of the Central Prairie, northern Texas, Oklahoma, and Kansas. Through the rest of the summer, it would follow the ripening wheat north, up through the Dakotas, almost 1,000 miles, sometimes running on a 100-mile front. Across the spaces somewhere loomed the grain elevator, maybe 10, 20 miles away, and the drivers lead-footed it there as fast as they could. Over the countryside, in boxes and carts and wagons, streamed the rivers of food to be processed and packed and readied for market. Fresh fruit and vegetables were on their way to market. Within the day, they might be eaten on the other side of the continent from where they grew. The trucks passed on the road, out to the orchards, into the cities, arriving at the elevator. Thank you. It had taken a year's work to raise the crop. You'd worried and dreamed about it through all those months, and then there it was, sitting there in a truck. And it all disappeared in a minute. Harvest didn't end in just a day, or just a few days. It kept on, moving across the land for many months. For those who were in it, the lasting impression of the experience came from the time when they finally rolled into the last acre. Over, finished and done. Day by day, the Earth completed another circle around the sun, and with it went another stride in a lifetime. But it was a very good year, and a man needs a good year occasionally to pick up and go again at the uncertain future.